apply to other professions, not just law enforcement, but other public servants who serve the state that have issues with private conversations and sensitive private data. And so we have a concern about that, and happy to work with the committee and continue to work on this bill.
I do have one question. Who are you with?
I'm sorry, the State Employees Association.
All right, I am going to work on an amendment, so if you can tell that to.
Wanted to do it.
Yes.
Welcome back.
Thank you.
Think I've seen you before.
Just a few times. Actually, I came here very early today specifically to speak on this one, just because that's what I believe in. I don't have any clearance from my board, so I'm not saying that I'm representing them. What I do have is my son, who went into prison with an eighth grade education, attention deficit disorder, and hyperactivity. He came out, and one of the things that that program taught him was to always back up what he was doing, to check and make sure he's doing everything right. And so the first place that we had to go was to the parole officers.
Oh, excuse me. Are you testifying on
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, I am. Hold on.
All right.
So the first place we had to go to was to the parole office. And I asked to go into that parole office with my son, and they would not allow it. He's straight out of prison. He's a big boy. He can take care of himself. So, okay, so I didn't get to go in. Subsequently, when he would go to parole, he asked if he could record what they were telling him. He has attention deficit disorder. He does not remember things. He was not allowed to record. He was not allowed to bring anyone into that parole office with him, so he has nothing that he can go back on to make sure that he's doing what he's being asked to do. They were so paranoid that my son was going to record them that when he went into their office with EEGs surgically glued to his head, they ordered him to remove them, and he refused. In refusing to do that, they could put him back into prison. What are they so afraid that he is going to record? We typically, and I've spoken with Department of Corrections, I've spoken with Department of Safety, my son has spoken with DOC, Department of Safety, our local police department. I have this little device right here that I leave on the desk, and I record here. My son says, "My name is Joseph Brooks, and you're speaking on a recorded line." I've never heard one police officer say, "No, you can't record me." And at that point, I'm very comfortable speaking with that official because I know that they're going to do what they're supposed to do. And if they don't do what they're supposed to do, we've got proof of what we said and what they said. Please pass this law. I remember back when it was a one-party consent, back in the 80s. If I'm on that phone call, I have a right to have a record of what I'm saying and what's said to me, especially if it can affect my life. And in my son's case, his freedom.
This is a suggestion. Experience that same thing again. Sometimes a note from a doctor will make all the difference in the world.
Sir, they haven't. You want to know what made the difference?
What?
Helen Hanks.
That works too.
No, Helen Hanks, Department of Corrections. Yes. He still is not allowed to record. And I still believe that he needs the right to be able to record 2 days later when he doesn't remember. You saw my son testify. Did you realize that what he said wasn't consistent in what he was talking? Because his mind wanders, and he had a computer screen in front of him. If your mind wanders and your life and your safety and your freedom depend on it, the department should not be allowed to stop him from recording. He needs it. It's a disability, but we can't even prove it. And they don't care. They're a public servant. My taxes pay the paycheck. Let me in there with my son, or let him have my little recorder that's not hurting anybody. And yes, that's behind closed doors.
I have the opposite problem. I have a granddaughter that lives with me. She's autistic. She remembers everything.
Yes.
Sometimes.
Too much.
Any questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you. I didn't hear it. 1546.
This is the earlier bill, 1546.
Okay, so I did submit one. Right, this is the recording one that we got suspended.
Yeah.
You wanna go talk? Am I up?
No, not yet. And Rice.
I very much appreciate that. Shoulder surgery. Thank you.
Welcome back.
Thank you. Nice to see you. For the record, I'm Ann Rice, I'm the Deputy Attorney General, I am appearing in opposition to this bill. We completely support the policy of government transparency and accountability, which is clearly the basis of this bill. However, I think that the language of the bill itself is very expansive and really creates some problems. So I'd like to go over some of those with you. There is no question that the Glick decision, which you've heard reference to earlier, allows for the recording of public servants in public areas. But that right to record is not unlimited. The Glick decision made clear that it could not interfere with a police officer's duties. And it could only be done in public places where the public has an unlimited right of access, which in that case was the Boston Commons. Since Glick, I think that you're aware, our office issued a law enforcement memo to all police departments in the state informing them of the Glick decision and the fact that public recording is allowed. To my knowledge, there have not been problems since that time. I know that there was a problem certainly in Ware early on. I am fully aware that the chief is well aware of that policy now. So I think that we've addressed that. But House Bill 1546 does not contain any limitations in terms of this right to record. It doesn't say anything about where the recording can take place, whether in a public area or a restricted area. It doesn't say that the recording can't interfere with a public servant's job. The right to record is not limited to conversation to which one is a party. It would allow recording of interactions between the public servant and a third party, even if the recorder wasn't involved in that conversation. Section 1 of the bill amends the definition of the criminal offense to say, to eliminate it being an offense to record if you are a party to it, or one party consents to the conversation. But that's different than Section 2, which says it is not unlawful under this bill to record a public official. It has no limitations. So the testimony that you heard earlier, or the questions, presuppose that it has to be someone who is involved in the actual conversation with a public servant. This bill doesn't say that. So if that's the understanding, and if that's the desire, this bill doesn't do that. And I think that's very important. It does not define public servant in any way. There is one different definition in the statutes, in the criminal code, under RSA 640:2, which defines a public servant as any officer or employee of the state or political subdivision thereof, including judges, legislators, consultants, jurors, and persons otherwise performing a governmental function. I'm assuming that the intent is to probably be that broad, although I have real concerns about saying that jurors, acting as jurors, are public servants that can be recorded. They should not, no recording should be allowed in a deliberative session. So the language of the statute is very broad in that sense. There is no requirement that people be told that they're being recorded. And I really have to question why it's not. Is the intent of the bill to trick people? Or is this the intent of the bill is to be able to make sure that people are behaving as you would expect a government, a public servant to? I think it's only fair that someone be told that they're being recorded. And there's nothing in here that suggests that. The bill would create conflicts with the enforcement of the right to know law and certain confidentiality laws. As I said, the way that it is written now, it is an absolute right to record a public servant.
It doesn't say you can't record when there's confidential information being disclosed. It doesn't say you can't record in non-public sessions of a select board or something like that. So those are all concerns that this bill would raise. It does not define where recording can take place, nor does it allow for imposition of any restrictions. Public servants work in all sorts of places. In my office, we have a public area where people come in. That's clearly a public area. We have a reception area where people are allowed after they get through a secure door. And then we have the secure back area of the building. Does the right to record include all of those areas? This bill would suggest that it does. And I think that that's very concerning. One of the things that I think about oftentimes is a district court office of the Division of Welfare, where people may have to go in and have discussions with caseworkers and things like that. I don't know in every situation how those offices are structured, whether there is an ability to have a confidential conversation with someone that's not in a public area. I hope there is. But I think that we need to consider that this bill is not just public hearings like this or the clerk at the DMV desk, but it would include any time that a public servant is functioning in their official function. And I think that there needs to be a definition to where that can take place. Although the bill is intended to create open and transparent government, I really do have some concerns that it may have the opposite effect. I think in New Hampshire, and we've just seen this with the primaries, is government officials here are very accessible to the public. I think that is one of the great joys of being in New Hampshire. But the prospect of being audio recorded is intimidating to a lot of people. And it can be particularly intimidating if you don't know if you're being recorded or not. So I think that it may cause some public officials to become reluctant to engage with the public, even in routine encounters. Much of our government is made up of volunteers, people who volunteer their services to the government. All of our, our licensing boards, those are all volunteers. And I have a great concern about being able to recruit people when we're imposing these kinds of laws. I am not saying that a licensing hearing is not a public hearing that can be recorded. Absolutely it is, but this goes far beyond that. So for all of those reasons, I would urge you not to pass this bill in its current form. We would be happy to work with the committee if there was a subcommittee formed on this, but I think the way that it is now, it's extremely broad. I'm happy to take any questions.
Well, before we get into that, Representative Burt is going to be working on an amendment. A couple of folks here have indicated a desire to work with him. So Representative Burt will be the contact person?
He will be the subcommittee chair?
I guess he is. Right now he's a single person on that, but I'm sure we can get a couple of folks to help him out.
Hopefully I can get some friends.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for taking my question. My concern is very specific, like what you mentioned, it's a vastness. Would you believe that there would be a lot more unintended consequences of tripping people up who are public servant or volunteers, and they're not, the role of a public servant versus a private citizen can change in an instant if you're in a public place?
I think I would believe that. I think that the lack of definition of a public servant is one of the critical things. And the fact that people aren't being told that they are being recorded, I do think that it can trip people up in a way that could make it very uncomfortable.
Follow up, Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Would you believe that this is almost like trying to tag, to find fault with the public servants? That's how I'm perceiving it. And would discourage a lot more of citizens to participate in a voluntary, and our state runs on volunteer
public service.
Yes, I would believe that, and I would agree with it.
Thank you.
Lieutenant Robinson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Taking the other side, if I'm talking to you, I hear you. My brain records what you said. But if I tell somebody else and you say, that didn't happen, it's my word against yours. The only reason I can believe I would be afraid of being recorded, or you being afraid to be recorded, is if one of us said something that was wrong.
Oh, I don't think that that's the only reason that someone would be afraid. I think being recorded can be very intimidating. I am used to it now, but I can tell you 10 years ago, it was not a comfortable thing for me to have to come into this room and know that I was going to be recorded. You get used to it. But for many of our government employees, being recorded is not something that happens all the time. And it's intimidating.
Okay, I don't understand it.
Okay. Number.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you. I'm trying to think how to say this. Project Veritas, if I say that word right, James O'Keefe. For years, we've had voter fraud in New Hampshire. The New Hampshire AG's office has said, no, it doesn't exist. But now you're going to investigate because of these tapes. Do you feel that these tapes, that these people did not know they were being videotaped, do you think they're useful today? Because now you're looking into this.
Are they useful today in terms of voter fraud?
Well, now that the New Hampshire AG, if I may, Mr. Chair, that now that New Hampshire AG's office, if I read the papers correctly in the news, is going to investigate voter fraud that has been happening in New Hampshire for years, now you're going to take a stand that you're going to look at it. And I think you're looking at it because of these tapes.
Well, I'm not going to comment on ongoing investigations. But I think you may be reading that a little I think that if there is voter fraud going on in terms of people giving false information to election officials, I think that's a very important thing to learn about.
Okay, and a follow-up?
Follow-up.
And in these videos, the elected officials were given a spin on how to beat the system, say, okay, if you don't live here, just say you live here. You know, isn't that useful to know that these elected officials in Portsmouth and Hanover are doing this?
I think that that is important information. I'm not sure that the way it was done is appropriate or fair. And that's as far as I want to go, because it is an ongoing thing. I understand what you're saying.
All right, and just one last follow-up.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. How do you feel on all the volunteers in 38 states, D.C., that allow one-party consent?
How do I feel about all the volunteers? I'm not sure what you mean.
You know, they have all, you know, I'm from Vermont, mm-hmm. and we're set up almost the same, except for they get paid a little bit more to be a state rep than I do.
Everybody does.
But they're basically volunteer legislators too. But they have one party consent over there, as well as 37 other states in D.C. So, I mean, if it happens in 38 states in D.C. and it works okay, why not New Hampshire?
I don't know that it works okay, but the big concern that I have had, and I hope that I've expressed this, is this isn't just one party consent to someone that's involved in the conversation. Because you're a public official and you are talking to a constituent, this would allow a third person to walk right up and tape record, regardless of whether either of you consents. Why is that fair to the constituent?
Why not? I think it is. Because the elected official is being videotaped, I just feel any time is appropriate.
I appreciate your stance. I think we have fundamentally...
I guess I would have to check on the 38 other states if they allow that third party to sneak in.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your testimony.
guess my question goes beyond the recording. Because, you know, if I do something, say something stupid, electron me, and somebody catches it, that's, you know, good for them. But what happens to these recordings and pictures after the fact? A little bit of malicious editing, and I can, you can make the reading of the Gettysburg Address sound evil. What are the protections for a public official who's been taped and then his comments have been edited and put out there maliciously?
I think that that's a concern with all of the access to recording now. I think that's a great concern, and I don't think it's just for this bill, but we see it all the time with kids and things that are being recorded with kids, and that gets posted on the internet in an edited fashion. So I appreciate the question. I do think it's a concern. I don't think it's limited to just this bill.
Thank you.
I see no further questions. Thank you very much for your testimony.
Thank you.
Now, we've got 8 minutes before the next hearing starts. And I've got quite a few cards here, so if there's something, if you have written testimony, if you can pass it in and maybe summarize it or do something, otherwise we're going to have to recess it again. Travis Pack, do you have written testimony?
I do not, sir. And in the interest of time, I'll waive my right to testify.
All right. You can turn in your testimony if you like and be found in the record. Daryl, is it...
Harry. I will be incredibly brief. Representative Burt, I do have some suggestions on the bill that I will email to you that I think alleviate some of the concerns. I think a couple of the sections here could be removed, and what I consider to be the main portion of the bill would stay intact, and that would be making New Hampshire a one-party consent state, as 38 other states plus Washington, D.C., and federal law are. Now, there have been suggestions that people would just randomly film state reps or elected officials eating a sandwich. And as a journalist, I have to say that I absolutely have zero interest in filming such a thing. And of all of the journalists I know, I can think of maybe one or two people that call themselves members of the media that would film such a thing, and probably only because they were bored and had nothing else to do that day. Now, Representative Birch, you keep asking questions about Project Veritas, and I realize that the Attorney General's office had said that they are going to investigate, but they have not said exactly what they are going to investigate, and I have to speculate that they will investigate whether or not Project Veritas committed a felony for surreptitiously recording. And that's something that, again, as a journalist, I am interested in, because where I'm originally from, Birmingham, Alabama, several of the news agencies there do hidden camera investigations. The one that sticks out in my mind the most was WBRC Channel 6. They had Six on Your Side, to where people could call about businesses that were defrauding people, ripping people off, and they would have an investigator go in and catch someone committing fraud on tape. If that were to happen in New Hampshire, that would be a felony. The investigative journalist would wind up possibly going to prison for several years. And that, I would say, is an absolute shame that real journalism is basically illegal in New Hampshire. So we definitely need to become a one-party consent state. And I was reading over some of the statutes in various other states. Arkansas, Hawaii, and I believe Indiana all have very similar wording that says it is neither eavesdropping nor a violation of privacy to record a conversation to which you are a party. So if you're involved in the conversation, you can record the conversation. And that is really the main aspect of this bill as far as I see. Because Section 1 of the bill would change to at least one party. And if you leave that, and I'll just go ahead and summarize the change that I would make if I were to amend this bill. I would strike section 2 and section 5.
Hold on a minute. We're not going to be talking about amendments to the bill because the bill, that is not before. You can talk to Representative Burt afterwards because he's going to be subcommittee chairman.
Yes. What was just stating, those two that I would repeal if I were in your shoes, and it keeps the single party consent and then just clarifies that certain things are not disorderly conduct, certain things are not obstruction of government administration. So the bill is good. I think that a couple of tweaks could make it an even better bill and would alleviate the concerns that have been expressed by the AG's office, the Municipal Association, and several other bureaucratic agencies. And I'll take any. One more thing before I say I'll take questions about malicious editing. I host a radio show. And there are things that get said on live radio that someone could go out and edit to make it sound like I said something absolutely stupid. And there's actually a soundboard online where you can do a Google search for Daryl Perry soundboard. And there are things that I've said that just a little, you know, half a second snippet makes it sound like I'm an absolute idiot. And there are things that journalists write that if you take one sentence completely out of context, it can make it appear as though they're an absolute idiot. So you don't need to say, well, if we can just randomly record public officials, somebody will edit it and make them look like an idiot. Well, all of these hearings wind up getting recorded in some fashion. The discussion on the floor of the House gets recorded. Somebody could go through that and pull out a snippet and make any single one of you state reps look like an absolute fool. So if the only objection is malicious editing, I think that's a very weak objection. So I would urge you to, again, pass this bill and I'll answer any questions.
Robertson has a question.
Isn't it a little easier to detect somebody editing a recording rather than my brain?
Yes.
What I repeat from my brain, which is edited?
Yes.
See, no further questions. Thank you very much. And again, in the interest of time, we've got 2 minutes.
I can make mine in that.
Today I'm here testifying as myself. I am the incident in Weir from 2010 that also went all the way to the First Circuit Court of Appeals. I was charged with wiretapping. My decision, and I'm actually not going to stick to my script here because I want to get time to address some of the issues that were brought up. First of all, to Attorney Rice, who I believe left, and all the state employees who got the chance to testify first, with a lot of time, and of course here we are down the wire. Unfortunately, she's not here, but the question that I would love the committee to ask her is Article 8 of the New Hampshire Constitution, which is the supreme law of the state, states that government, therefore, should be open, accessible, accountable, and responsive. There are no carve-outs, there are no exceptions, and that's pretty much what this bill is trying to do. We live in the 21st century. There are recording devices. If you're on the job and you're a public servant, you're on the job and you're on the record. It is that simple. I hate to say it, but really your personal feelings about how you feel about it, it's not relevant. You're a public official who swore an oath to the New Hampshire Constitution, and that requires you to be open and transparent. 38 states already have single-party consent. It's not a big deal. If the Department of Homeland Security can say to us, as citizens of this country, that if you have nothing to hide, you have nothing to fear, then I'm going to say to you today that if you have nothing to hide, you have nothing to fear from this bill. You should be on the record if you're a public official. I would urge you not to start down the path of diluting this. I have testified in front of several committees here for 5 years on this issue. I first came to the legislature when my court case was going on. Nobody wanted to help me. They said, no, try it in the courts. We tried it in the courts. I won. It cost the taxpayers of Weir tens of thousands, $57,500. It wasted a lot of my time and a lot of the town's time. And there's the case in Keene that also went all the way to the New Hampshire Supreme Court. So you guys have an opportunity today to actually put this to rest. Otherwise, I would say over time, we'll just see more and more and more lawsuits, which cost the taxpayers money. It wastes everyone's time. And, you know, this state gets a D minus for integrity, according to the latest reports, and that was reported on NHPR. So let's do something about it. On the job, on the record. With regard to the issue of malicious editing, that's a non-issue. If you're worried about that, you have the right to also record the conversation. If it's between two parties and someone comes in, that person can ask. And if there's an opportunity where someone is wondering why they're getting recorded, there's probably a situation where someone wants a record of it. So either the official can say, yes, you know what, you're here to help me out. I do want this on the record. Or you could make your own recording. Or the constituent, in that case, could also consent to the recording. Let me see if I covered everything I wanted to say. Oh, this is very important. In my case, the court found that because of the Glick decision, the officers do not have qualified immunity. Now, as everyone in this chamber probably knows, qualified immunity is public servants get out of jail free card. It's the one where you can say, for all of us, ignorance of the law is no excuse, but if you're a public official, apparently you're allowed to say, well, I'm the enforcer of the law, but yeah, I didn't know what the law said, so sorry, oops, my bad. In my case, they said, you can't do that anymore. So unless you guys figure out a way to make a bill that's good, on the job, on the record, what will happen, as there are more lawsuits, public officials will not be able to claim qualified immunity. So if you get filmed somewhere, you know today, because I'm testifying on it, that as a public official, you can be held personally liable in the case if it goes all the way up the chain of law command, right? That you can be held personally liable because you know that we are allowed to record you. So all I have to say, if anyone has any questions, let me know.
If there were a provision in this bill, say you recorded a conversation between yourself and, let's say, some law enforcement officer. If both parties get a copy of that recording, there should be no problem.
Well, yes, but I think actually, I'm obviously an individualist. I think if you want a recording, that's great. I think if you're a public official, I love the bill that said people should, law enforcement should start wearing body cams. I think that's helpful. Certainly in my case, there were body cams and cameras in the police department that didn't work that night.
Oh,
and when I subpoenaed them, or subpoenaed the records to prove that they had fixed the cameras that hadn't worked, there were no records that they were ever fixed. So either someone was telling a tall tale, and I know it wasn't me. So basically, I don't think people should be so scared of this idea. We live in the 21st century. These things are recorded anyway. And it's just a modern way to keep everyone on the up and up. It's really an opportunity for you guys to embrace something that will ultimately make your life better. Unless, of course, you have something to hide.
You know, honestly, I've had an experience with a selectman in my town some years ago where we had a group come in and we were trying to return a $500 check that the town had given this group. And we returned it because it was a charitable group, and charity is not, charity is when you give your own money, not when you give the town's money. And we went through this whole thing, and one of the selectmen went out of his board, swore, and there's a recording device up there. And he knew about it. The next morning, I was over at the town hall, and he says, "This is a recording device." I said, "Yes, it was." He says, "Can I get a copy of it?" I said, "I suppose, but I don't know who did it." later on I came back and I said, well, this was a recording from the civics class at the high school. End of story. Representative Mangiapudi.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for taking my question. Because this bill is intended only for the members in this chamber or the elected official, I wouldn't have any problem. The unintended consequences that I'm looking out for any public servant, it's beyond legislation, beyond police officials, beyond court system. We, in this state, have public servants that are not under any of these categories. They do not have any awareness or, you know, we are putting people under scrutiny for no reason, but it's more making everybody a hair-thin trigger of lawsuit.
That is,
that's, you know, I'm looking at this as a broad sweep, dragnet of things. So would you believe that this is a dragnet?
I would like to address that by saying the definition of public servant as it's written in this bill comes from another law or another section of the law. It is not defined originally in here. So somewhere in the wisdom in the past, it was decided that that is what a public servant is. So if that's the definition of a public servant, then surely we should use the definition of a public servant. So it's not truly great being overbroad, it is actually just using the language that already exists.
No further questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your testimony. All morning we seem to have heard everybody approach this as a negative thing. Would you not believe that this is a positive thing to show the good that public?
Yes, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think it's an opportunity. This is a way for New Hampshire also to be sort of a groundbreaker and to say, are we, as it states in the Constitution, are open and transparent. So really, it's an opportunity and it's a way to show the good. And filming police officers, for example, I see it as just witnessing. Someone can make an objective record that makes it easier for everyone to represent. To Robinson's point, why not have something that's objective? it's an opportunity, and I encourage everyone to vote ought to pass. Thank you.
If you don't further questions, for everybody's information, we're past the time that the other bill is supposed to start, but the chairman is not back. And where I'm the prime sponsor of this other bill, we'll just continue this hearing until the chairman comes back. Mr. Freeman.
Which one?
There's a whole bunch of us.
JP or Ian?
Oh, it's for Newton Brothers?
Well,
no, it's
JP?
We all...
That's me.
All right. Oops.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm J.P. Freeman, a.k.a. J.P. Freeman. My real name is Matthew Phillips. I live in Keene. I'm a reporter and correspondent for CopBlock.org in New Hampshire Regional CopBlock and Keene CopBlock. I got over 485 videos and I've CopBlocked in like 7 different states. I want to testify basically to the good that this bill can do. In fact, I just want to share one story. It's going to be very brief. An officer in Keene was arresting a young lady in a college neighborhood last September, this past September when school opened. And the girl basically accused him of groping her. And a sergeant ended up asking me, do you have that video dropped? And I actually gave him my SD card. I actually never got it back. And it actually cleared his name because he didn't grow up her during the time of the arrest, and it actually ended up saving his career. I'm pretty well known at vigorously going after police. In fact, I took a lot of flack with it, but I get along with more than not. as far as the Attorney General's office goes, most everything she said that was a concern is a personal concern. I think it came from out of emotion. It has nothing to do with the law. In regards to everything she has a concern with is basically covered by other laws. Interfering with government officials, interfering with government administration, that's a law. I know if I'm videotaping a cop or a police officer, I never interfere with their job in the traffic stop and make sure the traffic stop is clear because I know they're going to hit me with interfering with their job. And it's an unsafe thing, too. And there's also lawful orders in judgment of the police and public officials. And there's also other laws that cover their trespass notices and stuff like that to protect their in-home stuff. Like if two public officials are having a conversation about a young child for DHHS and so forth, which was another one of her concerns, there are confidentiality laws, federal and state, that protect children and protect confidentiality when it comes to medical records and DHHS records that the bill doesn't, get rid of. As far as the good points, I think most police, and I'm only specifically targeting police, I don't have a habit of going after any other official. I've been known to go after and videotape, bailiffs and stuff like that for trying to hinder your First Amendment rights. But they welcome the camera being there. In fact, they feel safer. If you're a lonely cop, a female cop in the corner of Keene, and she's talking to 30 college kids, and all of a sudden a cop walker's there with a camera, you can see that sigh of relief because her backup's not there yet. Mm. And there's another view of that, too. So that's all I want to say. Thank you for letting me speak.
Okay. Are there any questions? Seeing none, thank you very much. Hi, Ian.
Good afternoon. Thanks for keeping this going. I'm Ian Freeman. I host a radio show called Free Talk Live. I'm one of the bloggers at freekeen.com. I have a lot of experience creating media, and I have had a lot of experience on the streets and in government offices attempting to record government workers, and also on the phone as well. And I have to ask of these various different government bureaucrats who've come and testified against this bill today is, what are they afraid of? Because what I've heard from them, and I just want to answer some of these objections. The Municipal Association guy came in here and he said that, well, two of you reps could be recorded. Well, that's only true if one of you is doing the recording. The way this bill reads, it makes New Hampshire in line with the supermajority of the states. I believe you said 38 other states. This would allow one party to the conversation to record it. It does not allow someone who is not a party to record it. So the reason why the wiretapping laws were created in the first place was the old idea of somebody sitting outside of your house with a pair of headphones, literally tapping into a conversation that you were having. That's the classic definition of wiretapping. Someone who is not a party to the conversation, recording that conversation. This bill would not make that legal. That would still be a crime. And so some of the testimony from the government workers in here earlier tried to make it sound like this bill, if it passed, would all of a sudden make it legal to report a conversation that someone was not a party to. That is not the case at all with this piece of legislation. So again, what is it that they have to hide? What's the objection to secret recording? The Attorney General's lady was in here saying that it makes her uncomfortable to know that a conversation might be recorded secretly. Well, again, if she wants notice that someone is recording, that suggests that she would change how she behaves if she was given notice. So if what she's going to do is on the up and up and is honest, then she shouldn't need to be given notice. No one should need to be given notice of recording going on, which is what you have to do today. If I want to record a conversation with a government official, I have to give them notice. But even then, under a strict reading of the current wiretapping legislation, they could still charge me with wiretapping. And they sure have charged people. I'll just tell you a few brief cases.
That's not necessary because we're short of time.
I'm gonna keep it brief. I just want you to just one here. How about one? Two important cases. One, Ademo Freeman. He was recording a call, two calls with school board officials in Manchester, and he was charged with felony wiretapping for this. And he went to jail for a few months for this. And all he did was ask her some questions that should have been, you know, clearly on the record. But the prosecutor in Manchester went after him for that. And Chris David, he's right now facing wiretapping charges out on the seacoast. In his case, he didn't record a conversation with an official. He recorded a conversation with a bouncer outside the club. So outside, public place, having a conversation that anyone could have heard. But when he posted that video on YouTube, the bouncer, by the way, was threatening him, was what was going on in that video. So the bouncer was threatening him because he was driving for Uber at the time, and there's this whole Uber controversy out there. And so he's been charged. That case has yet to go to jury trial, but that is in the works right now. So we're talking about locking up a man who just had a baby and has a family, and now he's looking at prison time for that. So there's more of this. I've seen multiple people arrested in the courts, in Cheshire County Courthouse. They've been arrested for recording video openly, not even secretly. There's a standing order in Cheshire County Courthouse from both the Superior and District, because they're both in the same courthouse. Both the Superior and District judges have written a joint order that completely prohibits the recording in public spaces. Now, the excuse they use for this is that you might record the jurors or some minors. Well, this is BS, because if I want to record the jurors or the minors in the courthouse, all I have to do is stand outside, and I can record every single one of them as they go in and they go out. What this really is an order to protect the workers in the court from accountability. And this law would make it so government officials could be held accountable through secret recordings, as well as bad business owners, which was what Daryl was referring to earlier. You cannot do undercover recordings of, you know, scummy business owners. It's illegal for me to go in with a hidden camera into a dishonest business and capture that person on video. So this is a great piece of legislation. Please pass this. Thank you.
I see no other question. And the chairman is back. So I guess I can continue this past the time because the chairman wasn't here and I was the sponsor of the next bill.
Great sense of humor.
I try.
Mr. Chairman, can we rotate out of here for lunch?
Sure. Yeah, we can. We should be. Because the cafeteria closes in about 45 minutes. So
thank you.
We'll probably need to go get something to eat.
You're the one that kept talking.
The other one over here.